This video is brought to you by Brilliant. Today, the world reacts to a UN Security Council vote. Former Brazilian President Bolsonaro hides in a Hungarian embassy, and Belgium introduces compulsory voting for 16 and 17-year-olds. From TLDR News, this is your daily briefing for Tuesday, the 26th of March, 2024. On Monday, the UN Security Council adopted a resolution demanding an immediate ceasefire in Gaza, after the United States dropped its veto and abstained on the vote. Specifically, the resolution, which was brought forward by the Council's 10 elected non-permanent members, demands an immediate ceasefire for the month of Ramadan, respected by all parties, leading to a lasting, sustainable ceasefire, and also demands the immediate and unconditional release of all hostages. It also emphasises the need to expand the inflow of humanitarian assistance into Gaza, and demands the lifting of all barriers to this, and demands that all parties comply with their obligations under international law. The US decision to abstain rather than veto the resolution comes after months of Security Council deliberations and failed attempts to pass a resolution on the Gaza conflict. Since October, the US had vetoed three separate ceasefire-related resolutions. One in October for not mentioning Israel's right of self-defense, one in December for not explicitly naming and condemning Hamas, and one just last month, because, according to the US, it would put sensitive negotiations in jeopardy. During this same time period, two Gaza-related resolutions proposed by the US were vetoed by Russia and China for not directly demanding an immediate ceasefire. US Secretary of State Antony Blinken said that while the US did not agree with all the provisions of the resolution, adjustments made over recent days are, quote, consistent with our principled position that any ceasefire text must be paired with text on the release of the hostages. However, the US could not vote in favour because it did not include, quote, key language we view as essential, notably a condemnation of Hamas. UN Secretary-General Antonio Guterres said, this resolution must be implemented. Failure would be unforgivable. Now, UN Security Council resolutions are binding. However, there is effectively no enforcement mechanism, so the demands of the resolution are unlikely to go ahead. Nevertheless, it does mark a notable shift by the United States and is likely to put further strain on the US-Israel relationship. In response to the American abstention on the resolution, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu cancelled a planned visit by an Israeli delegation to the US and said the abstention would hurt the Israeli war effort and attempts to release hostages. The Palestinian representative at the UN welcomed the resolution, but said it has taken 6 months, over 100,000 Palestinians killed and maimed, 2 million displaced, and famine, for this council to finally demand an immediate ceasefire. If you're interested in this story, we'll have a full video about the vote and the impact on the US-Israel relationship coming out soon over on the TLDR News Global channel. There's more on the way, but be sure to subscribe and ring the bell to make the daily briefing part of your daily routine, or just search for us on your podcast app to listen along. Brazil's foreign ministry has summoned the Hungarian ambassador to explain why the former populist Brazilian president, a target of several criminal investigations, had spent two nights hiding in the Hungarian embassy in Brasilia last month. Jair Bolsonaro, who had been embroiled in lawsuits, dozens of federal investigations, and accused of helping stage a coup, termed as Brazil's January the 6th, once he failed to secure a second term in 2022. Earlier this month, Brazil's Supreme Court released documents showing that Bolsonaro tried to plot the coup with the support of, and even pressuring, military personnel, and plotted to jail a Supreme Court justice. Bolsonaro confirmed his stay at the Hungarian embassy for two nights, after the New York Times published security camera footage showing Bolsonaro being received by the Hungarian ambassador. Bolsonaro, referring to his friendship with populist Hungarian Prime Minister Viktor Orban, a firm supporter of the former Brazilian president, stated, I won't deny I was at the embassy. I maintain a circle of friends with some heads of state around the world. They are worried. Reports of Bolsonaro's stay at the embassy prompted calls for him to be detained to prevent him from escaping justice. Last week, Belgium's Constitutional Court ruled that 16 and 17-year-olds must vote in the upcoming European elections in June, under the country's system of compulsory voting. It came only 10 days before the deadline to register on the 31st of March, leaving at least 270,000 young people with just a few days to decide whether they want to vote. For context, Belgium first said that the voting age for the European Parliament should be lowered to 16, about 2 years ago, and then confirmed last May that 16 and 17-year-olds would be allowed to vote in this year's EU elections, which will be held alongside Belgium's federal and regional elections on June the 9th. A few months after this, the Constitutional Court ruled that registration wouldn't be needed, and voting for teenagers wasn't compulsory. However, a challenge was then taken to the court, arguing that it would be unfair for young people to have a choice on whether to vote, while adults are legally mandated to. Now, the latest ruling has concluded that young voters should be treated the same way as adults over 18, who are subject to fines if they do not vote. The court stated, the difference in the treatment of voters according to whether they're adults or minors does not appear to be justified by compelling reasons of public interest. Essentially, this means compulsory voting now applies to 16 and 17-year-olds too. But it's been criticised by politicians and youth organisations for coming so late. Belgian MEP Elaine Hutchinson told the Brussels Times that the lateness of the decision was regrettable, adding that he hopes it does not confuse or discourage young Europeans from voting in their first election. Moving to Senegal now, where opposition leader Bazirou Diomaye Faye looks set to become the next president. The election took place on Sunday, with millions casting their ballots, but as of right now, the exact result is unclear. Many of the 17 candidates standing in the election have conceded to Mr. Faye, including notably Amadou Ba, the former prime minister and the man the ruling coalition wants to become president. It now looks certain that Faye will become the next president. Under Senegal's voting system, a candidate needs to secure more than 50% of the popular vote in order to avoid a runoff vote. As things stand, it looks as though Faye has succeeded in this. This comes as a huge rejection of incumbent Macky Sall, who's been in power for 12 years and has presided over widespread poverty and high unemployment rates. Faye himself was in prison up until only 10 days before the election, but was released under a rapidly passed amnesty law. He was arrested in April 2023 and was found guilty of spreading false news, contempt of court, and defamation of a constituted body, following a social media post he made. Now, finally, in some more uplifting news, Croatia's parliament has announced that it's passing a law to recognise femicide as a crime. The new law will see that offenders face a minimum of 10 years in prison and has introduced harsher penalties for sexual violence. For instance, it's increased the prison sentence for rape from 1 to 5 years to 3 to 8 years. This comes as an important step towards gender equality in Croatia, a country with the third highest rate of femicides in the European Union, just behind Latvia and Lithuania. Now, understanding exactly what has or is going to happen here can be a little tricky, requiring you to evaluate lots of information from different, often partial, sources. It would be sensible then to begin improving your critical thinking skills so that you can keep sharp and better understand what's going on. And, well, our sponsor, Brilliant.org, can help you do just that. Brilliant is the online learning platform that's designed specifically to teach you everything from maths, data analysis, programming, and AI from the ground up. You don't need a fancy degree or to have dedicated hundreds of hours to studying any of these. All you need is a device with an internet connection and a few spare minutes a day. And with your spare few minutes, you'll learn by actually doing, with Brilliant providing hands-on lessons that help you play around with concepts, a method that has been shown to be 6 times more effective than just watching lectures. What makes this even better is that this content is created by an award-winning team of teachers, researchers, and professionals from MIT, Caltech, Duke, Microsoft, and more. To try everything that Brilliant has to offer free for a full 30 days, click on the link in the description. And that way, you'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription.